The first time I watched the film Matthias and Maxime, I instantly fell in love with it, but I wasn't able to put my finger on what it was about the film that made me connect to it so deeply. Turning, as I frequently do, to the social media app Letterboxd, I came across this one review that put words to a feeling that I didn't know I was having. The words gay yearning stuck with me. Two words that each make sense in describing the film. Gay, it's a film about two men. Yearning, who try and reconcile their love for each other. By themselves, the words seem obvious, but when combined, they gain a deeper meaning than they did individually. This video will be discussing the concept of queer yearning and how it's relevant in the film Matthias and Maxime.
Are you ready for your close-up?
To note, this essay will not only be using the word queer as an umbrella term for gender and sexual minorities, but also in its more political understanding, as described by Ellis Hansen, that queer is the no man's land beyond the heterosexual norm. Queer yearning is a difficult concept to pin down in words alone, which is why I thought the medium of video essay would lend itself well to this exploration, analysing visuals, movement and audio of the film. This video will discuss the historical and social contexts of queer yearning, before looking at its relationship to the film Matthias and Maxime. To yearn is to have an intense desire and longing for something. Although the word yearning has been used since the 12th century, Mary Retta notes that it has had two main resurgences in common vernacular. The first, she states, is an association with popular literature throughout the 18th and 19th century by female creatives like Virginia Woolf and Louisa May Alcott. The second being associated with internet spaces during the COVID-19 pandemic. It is during the second resurgence that the concept of queer yearning was popularised in a way of analysing queer media. Vivian Lamb researched the concept of queer yearning in 2022. She conducted interviews to try and drill down on what makes queer yearning unique in comparison to yearning more generally. One respondent said that queer yearning is different from heterosexual yearning because the stakes are different. Expanding, they say, when you're queer, the stakes aren't just does this person like me or return my feelings. It's not just a romantic context. The stakes are your safety, the stakes are your existence, the stakes are the possibility of violence, the possibility of rejection. Your love is already transgressive. The thematic trope of queer yearning is greater than just a crush. It also speaks to the collective queer yearning for safety, security and acceptance, for political freedom. Political writer and activist Lexi McMenamin takes this line of thought further and supposes that it's a privilege for queer yearning to be at the centre of modern queer media. Queer stories began to find their mainstream voice in the late 1980s, early 1990s, amongst the AIDS epidemic, and were connotated with themes of shame, disease, sin, and death. Through this lens, the movement towards queer yearning can be seen as political. The queer community no longer feels the need to hide from shame, but instead long for something better. Queer yearning emerges from a sense of being othered and marginalised, and when encountered, acts as a radical force that disrupts societal norms. To quote Mary Retta for a final time, queer yearning is an act of rare imagination to envision a world where all your needs are met. It is the hope against hope that one day we will live the lives that we deserve. Gender and queer theorist Jack Halberstam calls this envisioned world the queer utopian vision. Returning now to Xavier Dolan's 2019 film Matthias and Maxime, we can analyse how the concept of queer longing visualises and actualises itself within the film.
Max, it's Lotsu.
Matthias and Maxime is a film about two lifelong friends in their 30s who have to navigate the realisation that they are actually in love. The love behaves as a disruptive force in the film.
Tell your letters.
Acting as a threat to their friendship and the stability of their lives more broadly. It also acts as a threat to their identity and sense of self. Writer and director of the film, Xavier Dolan, explains this as...
Love comes knocking on your door and you are unprepared and it's inexplicable. What unites them is the strength of their friendship. And what really troubles them in this thing that is trying to break in, because they've known each other forever since they're 5 and now they're 30. So where has that love been their entire life?
This form of identity-shifting love, falling in love that makes you reconsider who you thought you were, is fairly unique to the queer community. Your first queer relationship is not just a new relationship, but also a new culture, a new identity. as well as leaving behind an old life and the privileges that come with being perceived as heterosexual. The men have to balance the feelings they are having for each other with this new thing in their lives that affects their very identity. In this way, the men's love can be described as queer yearning. Matt and Max are not only yearning for each other, but also for an explanation and an understanding of their relationship and their own identities. One of the ways queer yearning can visualise itself in film is the presence of distance. Both in a physical sense, the characters are often positioned at opposite sides of the room or on opposite sides of the frame, and in a narrative sense, the characters keep themselves closed off from each other. The use of framing and narrative distance is relevant to queer yearning because it helps visualise the internal struggle of the men wanting to be near to each other but being forced to be distant out of fear of the aforementioned stakes of safety, existence, violence and rejection. This conflicting internal struggle can be visualised in one scene in particular. Dolan uses an aspect ratio change into widescreen to position the men at the furthest point that the screen will allow. Wendy Eild writes of this scene. Matt and Max never express their yearning for each other verbally. Instead, it is insinuated and realised through their performance and through the film's cinematography. This space of non-verbal communication of love is the place that many queer stories have historically been forced into, whether through legislation like the Hays Codes, which banned overt queer stories in Hollywood until 1968, or through cultural homophobia, which hid queer stories into the fringes of screen. Queer stories, more so than heterosexual stories, rely on insinuated love due to this cinematic history. Vivian Lamb writes how this history influences queer yearning, explaining that in heterosexual love stories, the tension can be cut with a romantic or sexual resolution. In queer stories, however, this resolution was forbidden to them, so the tension is forced to grow and grow. The film's slow pacing and introspective narrative invites the audience into the two men's life in a very personal way. With the use of a handheld eye-level camera, the audience is invited to feel the yearning as if it's happening to themselves. One scene in particular, Dolan stretches the tension of yearning to its breaking point. Dolan's film takes influence from this narrative tradition of implicit love in queer stories, however takes it into the modern age. He allows for the yearning to grow at a distance, but breaks the cycle by allowing the men to have an intimate moment on screen. Xavier Dolan's plot breaking this trope of unexhibited love could perhaps depict the next stage in queer stories, using the thematic tropes of queer yearning, but using it to show stories where yearning is attained, allowing to tell more complex and optimistic queer stories in the future. Defining the concept of queer yearning remains elusive, and perhaps it is something that can only truly be understood by embodiment. However, in attempting to make a manageable synopsis of the feeling for this video, I came to a better understanding of the concept and of the film Matthias and Maxime. The movie depicts a yearning not only for love, but for an understanding also. Dolan ends with the message that this yearning maybe one day will pay off, individually and collectively, that we will achieve the queer utopian vision. And that is exactly why I love him. Those cool kids stuck in the past, palms of cigarette ash. Wait outside until it begins. Won't be the first ones in. Spend your life.